Evacuation emergency. More than 2,000 people have spent the night in evacuation centres across northern New South Wales. 9,000 are now isolated by floodwaters and levels are still rising. And parts of Queensland are under siege and underwater from the worst flooding they've ever seen. More towns are on alert today. We've got the very latest on Australia's flood chaos. 6am Friday, February 3rd. Good morning, everyone. I'm Ron Wilson.
And I'm Ellie Southwood. Welcome to 10's Early News. Also this morning, scores still missing from a ferry disaster in Papua New Guinea as Australian rescue teams search for survivors.
In sport, pre-season training heats up in Adelaide as Crows teammates turn on each other.
And in finance, the axe swings at Westpac. Hundreds of jobs are under threat.
Today's weather making all the headlines, of course, but the trough in the east will weaken and allow rain and storms to ease. A low should develop in the monsoon trough over the Coral Sea and direct rain and storms over northern Queensland. Well, it's been a long night for thousands of people forced into evacuation centres across northwest New South Wales and parts of Queensland. Thousands more remain isolated by rising floodwaters. Worst hit in New South Wales, the towns of Moree and Taree. The State Premier is on his way there this morning to see the flooding for himself.
Moree has barely recovered from flooding in November, but now the small New South Wales town is facing its worst inundation in 35 years. A huge deluge saw the region hit with more than a month's worth of rain in just 24 hours. 1,600 people were forced into evacuation centres as the swollen Mihai River threatened to burst its banks. Dozens had to be airlifted to safety. Low-lying homes and businesses in the centre of town are expected to be flooded as downpours continue throughout the day.
The good news is many have taken our advice and have left early, gone to friends' places and relatives' places, those sort of things. But a lot of people registering at evacuation centres, as well as other small townships around the Moree area.
A further 1,650 residents may be asked to leave their homes in the neighbouring town of Weewaw this morning as the Namoi River threatens to flood. New South Wales Premier Barry O'Farrell will tour the flood-hit areas after the government declared five towns natural disaster zones, bringing the total number statewide to 16. Around 9,000 people remain isolated around the state, with authorities warning people not to try and drive through floodwaters. Chris O'Keefe, 10 News.
Of course, New South Wales isn't the only state suffering. Much of central and southern Queensland is also underwater. Mitchell is enduring its worst ever flood. The swollen Maranoa River has inundated numerous homes and more are expected to go under, with predictions of a 9 metre peak.
Hopefully everyone uses their common sense and keeps out of the water.
A disaster situation has been declared and about 50 residents have spent the night at a makeshift evacuation centre. Weather forecasters say the flooding is only going to get worse, with eight other regional Queensland towns bracing for disaster. A monsoonal trough is threatening to dump over 100 millimetres of rain in the next 24 hours. Bolan, Charleville, Tambo, Roma, Winton, Blackall, Eulo and Quilpie are all on flood alert, and the Maranoa is expected to peak above 13 metres on Sunday or Monday. Rough seas and poor weather are hampering the search for as many as 100 people missing after their ferry sank off the east coast of Papua New Guinea. Australia is providing assistance to rescue teams as the country comes to grips with its worst ever maritime disaster.
The ferry was en route from the island of New Britain to the mainland city of Lae when it sent out a distress signal. On board, more than 350 people, many local teachers and students.
This is obviously a major tragedy.
This is what the ferry looked like. It sank near the end of its 20-hour journey. Around 240 people have so far been pulled from the choppy waters, but confusion reigns.
I've got no idea how many people are still missing. As I said, you know, we probably have seen 100 survivors still in the water.
Australian boats and aircrafts have joined the search, which has been hampered by rough seas.
The weather is quite rough out there. Even offshore, we had quite a bit of turbulence, which came from off the mountains.
But they're hopeful of rescuing many more survivors today.
We have not seen any deceased in the water. The only people we have seen were either in lifecrafts or onboard floating devices.
The cause of the disaster is still unclear. Tegan George, 10 News.
The South Australian bikie gang leader, who survived a fourth assassination attempt that claimed the life of his son, has been arrested on drug charges. Comanchero President Vince Foccarelli will face a bedside court hearing from hospital today, where he's recovering after the shooting earlier this week. The 37-year-old is facing drug possession charges, as well as 12 counts of breach of bail. Police say Foccarelli has refused to cooperate with them over the shooting that killed his son. Queensland celebrity chef Matt Galinsky is showing signs of improvement, more than a month after a tragic house fire claimed the lives of his wife and three young daughters. The 39-year-old received third-degree burns to 40% of his body while trying to save his family. He remains in a heavily sedated state in the Royal Brisbane Hospital, but for the first time is experiencing brief periods of semi-consciousness. While he's not able to walk or talk yet, his father says he's encouraged by his progress. The TV chef is expected to remain in hospital for several more months. Being down to your last $60,000 doesn't really classify as being broke, but when your mother is Australia's richest woman, it can spark a family feud. Three of mining magnate Gina Rinehart's four children are challenging their mother's right to continue to act as trustee of the family's multi-billion dollar trust fund. Court documents have revealed one of her daughters complained she was down to her last $60,000. She also urged her mother to provide her with a cook and bodyguard, claiming they are the most high-risk family in Australia due to their wealth. Britain's highest court has today retired to consider the fate of Australian WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. The 40-year-old appealed to the Supreme Court to block his extradition to Sweden to face sex assault allegations. Assange's lawyers argue his arrest warrant is invalid because it wasn't issued by someone with the proper authority. The court could take weeks to reach a decision. If extradited, Assange would have 10 days to leave Britain, but can appeal again from Sweden. Sport, and in-form wicketkeeper Matthew Wade will again be aiming to impress tonight when Australia takes on India in the second 2020 match at the MCG. The Victorian is pushing hard for a test spot, but incumbent Brad Haddin said he's not feeling threatened.
Matthew Wade is fitting in very well at the top level and his timing's good too. The diminutive Victorian filling his boots at a time when the wicket-keeping spot might just be up for grabs.
Obviously, you try not to think about that too much. There's a lot of talk out there, but obviously, Hads is the test keeper at the moment and I'm comfortable with that. I'm doing my 2020 stuff and I'll start in the one day. So I think if you put too much pressure on yourself, you're not going to go out there and play the way that you can play.
Brad Haddin didn't see Wade smashing his 72 on Wednesday night. He was driving to Canberra to captain the PM's 11 and says he's not concerned.
Well, that's big, really big.
I'm very comfortable where everything's at the moment. I know exactly where I stand and I know exactly what's going on over the next couple of weeks.
Wade has another chance to impress in the second 2020 match at the MCG tonight. Nathan Templeton, 10 News.
The Adelaide Crows clearly mean business in 2012. Even teammates are coming to blows on the training track. Big forward Taylor Walker didn't take too kindly to this close attention from Matthew Yench, but the club is not concerned.
To someone's natural instincts, I think you're almost blunting what they can do in the game.
Walker had the last laugh, though, when a seemingly accidental blow left Yench in quite a bit of discomfort. In the right spot too. Time for Finance News now with Ellie Southwood, and all we've talked about this week seem to be job losses and more of them.
Yeah, this time at Westpac, Ron. Australian jobs have been dealt another blow with hundreds of Westpac employees set to be laid off. The bank plans to cut 560 jobs. Of those, 150 positions from lending operations will be sent offshore, while 400 jobs will be cut from support and backroom processing. The bank says it plans to reskill or redeploy some workers in a bid to minimise the impact. The finance sector union says the bank's customer service will decline as a result of the cuts. The price of catching a Qantas or Jetstar flight is about to soar because of higher fuel costs. From the 15th of February, both domestic and international ticket prices will rise due to more expensive jet fuel and carbon pricing. Passengers will be slugged up to $60 extra one way. Qantas's fuel costs have increased by $450 million in just the past 6 months. Meantime, Singapore Airlines says its third quarter net profit has tumbled 53% from a year ago due to persistently high fuel prices. The airline, considered a bellwether for the industry, says its net profit in the 3 months to December fell to $100 million. Taking a look at the global markets now, and stocks have edged higher as a Greek debt deal looms closer and merger talks are confirmed between Xstrata and Glencore, which, if successful, could create an $82 billion mining giant. The Dow Jones has seesawed, helped along by better jobless figures, but right now it's down 14 points. The Nasdaq is up about 7. In Europe, and all the main markets finished higher, led by the miners. In Asia, and the Nikkei closed in positive territory for a third straight day, despite technical glitches interrupting trade. To the commodities, and oil is lower this morning, trading at $95 a barrel. Gold is up. One Australian dollar is buying 107 US cents and 81 euro cents. Our market closed in positive territory yesterday, but the SPY is currently pointing to a weaker start to the day.
Well, it's a wet argument in most of our major centres today. Brisbane, a possible shower, 28. Sydney, showers, 24. Canberra, showers, 21. Melbourne, the standout, mostly sunny and 27. Hobart, a late shower, 22. Adelaide, mostly sunny, 30 degrees, very nice. Perth, showers and 29. And Darwin, thunderstorms and 32.